Venezuela crisis, Maduro defiant as pressure builds. Venezuelan President Nicolas Maduro has said he cannot rule out the possibility of civil war as pressure mounts on him to stand down. In a TV interview, he warned that U.S. President Donald Trump would leave the White House stained with blood if he intervened in the crisis. He also defiantly rejected the EU's Sunday deadline to call snap elections. Opposition leader Juan Guaido declared himself interim president and won the backing of the U.S. and others. Mr. Guaido said on Sunday he would build an international coalition to deliver humanitarian aid to Venezuelans. But Mr. Maduro has accused him of organizing a coup. In the interview with Spanish television program Salvados, broadcast on Sunday, Mr. Maduro was asked if the crisis in Venezuela could result in civil war. "Today no one could answer that question with certainty," he said. "Everything depends on the level of madness and aggressiveness of the Northern Empire, the U.S., and its Western allies. We ask that nobody intervenes in our internal affairs and we prepare ourselves to defend our country." President Trump has told U.S. broadcaster CBS that the use of military force remains an option. But Mr. Maduro warned the U.S. leader he risked a repeat of the Vietnam War if he intervened. "Stop. Stop. Donald Trump. You are making mistakes that are going to stain your hands with blood and you are going to leave the presidency stained with blood," he said. "Let's respect each other, or is it that you are going to repeat a Vietnam in Latin America?" Sunday saw the expiry of a deadline set by several European countries, including France, Britain, Germany and Spain, for Mr. Maduro to call early presidential elections. They said that they would recognize Mr. Guaido as interim president if no such pledge was forthcoming. But Mr. Maduro responded, "We don't accept ultimatums from anyone. It's like if I told the European Union, I give you 7 days to recognize the Republic of Catalonia. And if you don't, we are going to take measures." No, international politics can't be based on ultimatums. That was the era of empires and colonies. Thousands took to the streets of the capital Caracas on Saturday for protests in support of both President Maduro and Mr. Guaido. Mr. Maduro retains the support of the military, but ahead of the demonstrations Mr. Guaido received a boost when an Air Force general, Francisco Yanez, became the highest-ranking military official yet to pledge support for him. Mr. Guaido says he has held private meetings with the military to win support for ousting Mr. Maduro. He says he has also reached out to China, one of Mr. Maduro's most important backers. Mr. Guaido does not control any territory in Venezuela, so instead he plans to set up collection centers in neighboring countries where Venezuelans have fled to. He said he wanted to set up an international coalition to gather aid at 3 points, and press Venezuela's army to let it into the country. U.S. National Security Advisor John Bolton said on Twitter that plans were being advanced over the weekend. Mr. Maduro has rejected letting aid into the country, telling supporters on Saturday, "We've never been nor are we a country of beggars." Venezuela has suffered economic turmoil for years, with hyperinflation and shortages of essentials such as food and medicine. Millions have fled.
Video. history that goes back centuries. A Pew Research poll in 2014 found that 62% of Venezuelans had a favorable opinion of the U.S., but their leaders haven't always seen eye to eye. How did it go from this?
Mr. Kennedy is the first U.S. president to visit Venezuela.
To this? We have many options for Venezuela, including a possible military option. To understand the relationship between Venezuela and the U.S., we have to know that it mainly revolves around one precious resource, oil. The first oil wells were drilled in the early 20th century. By 1940, Venezuela became the third largest producer of crude oil in the world. From the beginning, American companies were heavily involved, and the U.S. also bought the majority of the country's oil. And in 1961, John F. Kennedy made the first official visit of a U.S. president to Venezuela.
Liberty and economic progress go hand in hand.
Here's Jackie Kennedy delighting the crowd with a few words of Spanish. The Cold War, oil, trade set the tone for decades of friendship. During the Cuban Missile Crisis, Venezuela backed the U.S. against its Caribbean neighbor. And in the 60s and 70s, the country experienced an oil bonanza. Thousands of U.S. oil workers and businessmen took their families to live in Venezuela and work in their oil fields. With them, they brought American culture, food, fashion. Venezuelans lapped up all things American, and the country became one of the most dependable markets for U.S. consumer goods. But not everyone was such a fan of the U.S. During this whole time, there was always a large part of the population that was against the influence of the superpower. And despite the huge oil boom, large sections of society remained poor. All the while, the pro-U.S. political elite in the country grew richer. This angered no doubt its history, and built up until 1998, when Hugo Chavez was elected president in a landslide victory. In the beginning, Chavez wasn't that anti-American firebrand he later became. Washington cautiously welcomed the new leader and adopted a wait-and-see attitude. That all changed in 2002 when a military coup overthrew Chavez for 48 hours. He was convinced that the U.S. was behind the plot. Today, though, we know that America